This is Concept E Classes and today we'll study Chapter 6 of Class 8 NCERT History, Weavers, Iron Smelters and Factory Honours. So in this chapter, first we'll see about the Indian textiles and the world market. Under that, we'll see certain words which tells us the history of the Indian textiles, then about the Indian textiles in European markets, then we'll discuss who were the weavers and what happened to the Indian textiles. And finally, about the cotton mills that came up at that time. Then we'll discuss about the sword of Tipu Sultan and wood steel, about the abandoned furnaces in the villages, and also deal with the iron and steel factories that came up in India. In the previous chapters, we saw how the Indian kings, the landlords, the tribals, all were affected by the East India Company and their policies. In this chapter, we'll study about the crafts and industries of India during British rule by focusing on two main industries at that time, namely the textile and the iron and steel industry. And we'll see how it affected the weavers, iron smelters and the factory owners as well. Now, both these industries, that is the textile as well as the iron and steel industries, were crucial for the industrial revolution. Let's see how Britain was industrialized. The mechanized production of cotton textiles made Britain the first industrial nation in the 19th century. Similarly, Britain came to be known as a workshop of the world as iron and steel industry started growing in 1850. Now, this industrialization of Britain had a close connection with the conquest and colonization of India. We saw in Chapter 2 how the East India Company came to India for trade and how they settled in our country, and later they started buying goods in India and exported them to England and Europe, making huge profit. So this is an image of the trading ships that were found in the port of Surat at that time. And it was one of the most important ports in the Indian Ocean trade. We have discussed this in Chapter 2. If you have any doubt, please refer that slides. Hence, the British industrials began to see India as a vast market for their industrial goods. And after a period of time, the Britons started flooding Indian markets with their goods. Now, how did this affect Indian crafts and industries? That's what we are going to see in this chapter. So first, let's see about the Indian textiles and the world market. Now, before the Britishers came to India, around 1750, India was the world's largest producer of cotton textiles. And Indian textiles was famous for both their quality as well as their exquisite craftsmanship. And hence they were traded in Southeast Asia, West and Central Asia as well. From the 16th century, the European trading companies, they began buying Indian textiles for sale in Europe. For example, this Patola weave. It was woven in Surat, Ahmedabad and Patan. And it was a highly valuable clothed in Indonesia, and it became a part of the local weaving tradition there. Now, memories of this trade and craftsmanship of Indian weavers are preserved in many words that we still use in English. So let's trace down some of these words and let's understand how these words came into existence and see what they tell us. Now let's discuss about the words which tell us the history of Indian textiles. European traders first encountered a fine cotton cloth from India carried by Arab merchants in Mosul, which is present day in Iraq. So they called these finely woven textile as muslin. This also is a fine muslin which is called as jamdani, on which decorative motifs are woven and typically in grey and white. And often a mixture of gold and cotton thread was used. And the most important centers of jamdani weaving were Dhaka in Bengal and Lucknow in United Provinces. Similarly, when Portuguese first came to India in search for spices, they landed in Calicut on Kerala along the southwest coast. And the cotton textiles which they took back to Europe along with the spices came to be called as calico, which is derived from the name Calicut, and then calico became the general name for all the cotton textiles. Now, just like muslin and calico, there are many other words which point to the popularity of Indian textiles in Western market. Here you can see a page of an order that the English East India Company sent to its representatives in Calcutta in 1730. Here we can see like corsets, then we have bandana. So this order that year was for about 5,89,000 pieces of cloth, and this list had 98 varieties of cotton and silk pieces. Now this piece actually here means a cloth which is 20 yards long and 1 yard wide, and these orders, they had to be placed 2 years in advance. Now, among the different varieties of cloth pieces that we saw in the previous slide, there are certain printed cotton clothes called as chins, corsets or bandana. Now, where do these chins or corsets, these English terms came from? They actually is derived from Hindi words. For example, chins. It is derived from the Hindi word chint, a cloth with a small and a colorful flowery design. And from 1680s, this floral design became a trend in England and Europe, and so all the rich people, even the queen herself, started wearing this Indian fabric. Now this is an example of a chintz cloth which is produced in Musulipatnam, Andhra Pradesh, for the export to Iran and Europe. Similarly, bandana, that is nowadays we use that brightly colored or printed scarf in the neck or head. It was actually derived from the term bandana, Hindi word for tying, and it is referred to a variety of brightly colored cloth produced through method of tying and dyeing. Similarly, other clothes were also noted by their place of origin. For example, Kasim Bazar, Patna, Calcutta, Orissa, Charpur. Hence, by the use of such words, we can understand how popular Indian textiles had become in different parts of the world. So let's now discuss about the Indian textiles in European markets. By the early 18th century, the Indian textiles became very popular, and hence the wool and the silk makers in England, they began protesting against the import of Indian cotton textiles. And in 1720, the British government passed a legislation banning the use of chintz in England. And this act came to be known as Calico Act. Now, why were these wool and silk makers in England protesting? Because they were unable to compete with the Indian cotton textiles, and they wanted to secure their market by preventing the entry of this Indian textiles. And even under their government protection, they set up a calico printing industry, and they started imitating the Indian designs and printed in England on white muslin or plain unbleached Indian cloth. At this time, actually, the textile industries had just begun to develop in England. Hence, the competition with this Indian textiles, they also led to the search for technological innovations in England. So let's see what all new technologies were invented in England. So one such technological innovation was a spinning jenny in 1764, which was invented by John Kaye, which increased the productivity of the traditional spindles. So the spinning jenny was actually a machine by which a single worker could operate several spindles. So this is a spindle, see, several spindles onto which the thread was spun. And when this wheel was turned, all the spindles rotated. And the spinning jenny, it increased the productivity. Even the invention of steam engine by Richard Arkwright in 1786 revolutionized the cotton textile weaving. So because of all these technological innovations, cloth was now woven very easily and in immense quantities and cheaply too. However, the Indian textiles continued to dominate the world till 18th century, and the European trading companies like the Dutch, the French, the English, they made enormous profit out of this. And these companies, how did they purchase this Indian textiles? By importing silvers. And later, when the Britishers came to India and when East India Company acquired Bengal, they collected the revenues and peasants from peasants and zamindars, and they used that revenue to buy Indian textiles instead of importing silver. We saw this in chapter 2. So if you have any doubt, please refer that slides. So we saw how the Indian textiles were in high demand in the 18th century. So let's discuss some of the major centers of weaving in India in the late 18th century. The textile production was concentrated in four regions in the early 19th century, and Bengal was one of the most important centers as it was located near the rivers. They could easily transport goods to distant places. Similarly, Dhaka in eastern Bengal, which is now Bangladesh, it was the foremost textile center in the 18th century. Then in the south, there was a cluster of cotton weaving centers along the Coromandel coast, stretching from Madras to Andhra Pradesh. So here we can see Pondicherry, Nagapattinam, Mosulipattinam, etc. And on the western coast, there were important weaving centers in Gujarat as well. So we saw how the Indian textiles were in huge demand in European markets. So now let's see who were specialized in making these textiles. They were the weavers. Now weavers, they often belong to communities that specialized in weaving, and the skills were passed on from one generation to next. So some of the communities which are famous for weaving in India are the Tanti weavers of Bengal, the Mumin weavers of North India, Sel, Kai Kullar and Devangs of South India. These all were the communities which are very famous for weaving. Now the first stage of production was spinning, and it was mostly done by women. They used household spinning instruments like the charkha and the takli. The thread was spun on the charkha and rolled on the takli. And when the spinning was over, the thread was woven into the cloth by the weaver. Now the weaving was a task done by the men. For colored textiles, the thread was dyed by the dyer, which was called as rangrees at that time. And for printed cloth, the weavers needed the help of specialist block printers known as chipigars. Now, handloom weaving and the occupations associated with it provide livelihood for millions of Indians at that time. So let's see what happened to the Indian textiles. They started declining. And what was the reason? It was mainly the development of cotton industries in Britain, and that affected the textile producers in several ways. First, the Indian textiles now had to compete with the British textiles in European as well as American markets. And secondly, very high duties were imposed on the Indian textiles which were imported into Britain. Hence, exporting also became difficult. And by the beginning of 19th century, the English made cotton textiles successfully ousted Indian goods from their traditional markets in Africa, America and Europe. As a result, thousands of weavers in India became unemployed. The Bengal weavers were the worst hit. And English and European companies, they stopped buying Indian goods, and they no longer gave any advances to the weavers as well. As a result, many weavers, they were very distressed, and they even wrote petitions to the government to help them. So the situation only got worse. By 1830, the British cotton cloth flooded the Indian markets. That is, in fact, by 1880, two-thirds of all the cotton clothes worn by Indians were made of cloth produced in Britain, and thousands of Indian weavers and spinners were made jobless. However, handloom weaving, it did not completely die in India, because some types of cloth, they could not be supplied by machines. For example, the saris with intricate borders or the clothes with traditional woven patterns, they could not be made by machines. Hence, these clothes still had a wide demand. And the British, they also do not produce very coarse clothes which were used by the poor people in India. And in late 19th century, Solapur in western India and Madura in south India emerged as an important new centers of weaving. Later, during the national movement, Mahatma Gandhi urged people to boycott this imported textiles and use hand-spun and hand-woven cloth. And that's how gradually khadi became a symbol of nationalism. The charkha, it came to represent India, and it was put at the center of the tricolor flag of Indian National Congress and adopted it in 1931. So what happened to all the weavers and spinners who lost their jobs or livelihood? Many weavers, they became agricultural laborers. Some migrated to cities in search of work. Some went out of the country to work in plantations in Africa and South America. And some of these handloom weavers, they also found work in the new cotton mills that were established in Mumbai, Ahmedabad, Solapur, Nagpur and Kanpur as well. Then cotton mills came up. The first cotton mill in India was set up as a spinning mill in Bombay, 1854. Now, from early 19th century, Bombay grew as an important port for the export of raw cotton from India to England and China. And it was close to the vast black soil tract of Western India where cotton was grown. Hence, it was easy for them to get raw material. We have discussed more about this cotton mill in your geography chapter 5 industries. I will add it as an end screen to this video. If you have any doubt, please refer that slides. And by 1900, over 84 mills started operating in Bombay, and most of them were established by Parsi and Gujarati businessmen who made a lot of money through trade with China. Mills also came up in other cities, like the first mill in Ahmedabad, which was started in 1861. A year later, a mill was established in Kanpur, and growth of this cotton mill led to the demands for labor. Hence, thousands of poor peasants, artisans and agricultural laborers, they moved to the cities to work in the mills. However, the textile factory industry in India faced many problems. First, it found it difficult to compete with the cheap textiles produced from Britain. Secondly, in most countries, the government, they supported the industrialization by imposing heavy duties on the imports. That is, if we try to import our textiles, they used to impose heavy duties and it was hard for us. And thirdly, the colonial government in India, they refused to give protection to local industries. However, the first major spurt in development of cotton factory industry in India was during the First World War. That is, we received support during the First World War when the Indian factories were called upon to produce cloth for military supplies. So now the next topic is the sword of Tipu Sultan and the wood steel. Now the story of Indian steel and iron metallurgy begins by remembering the famous story of Tipu Sultan who ruled Mysore till 1799. In the previous chapter, we saw how Tipu Sultan fought four wars with the British and died fighting with his sword in his hand. And Tipu's legendary swords are now a part of a valuable collection in the museums in England. So this is the sword of Tipu Sultan. Now, the sword of Tipu Sultan was very special. Why? Because the sword was incredibly hard. It was very hard and the sharp edge could easily rip through the opponent's armor. And this quality of sword came from a special type of high carbon steel called as woods, which was produced all over South India. And the wood steel, when made into swords, it produced a very sharp edge with a flowing water pattern. In the next slide, I'll show you that. Okay. And this pattern came from a very small carbon crystals embedded in the iron. So that's why Tipu's sword was very special. Now here, if you see this sword, we can see that there are quotations from the Quran and it was written in gold in the steel handle of Tipu's sword. And here there is also a tiger head towards the bottom of the handle. This is a flowery pattern that we mentioned in the previous slide. Okay, so this is a Wood's sword. Now, Francis Buchanan, he toured through Mysore in 1800 and he gave an account of the technique by which wood steel was produced. Now, wood steel was produced in many hundreds of smelting furnaces in Mysore. What do you mean by smelting? It is a process of obtaining a metal from a rock by heating it to a very high temperature. Now, in these furnaces, the iron was mixed with charcoal and put inside small clay pots. And through very intricate control of temperatures, the smelters produced steel ingots that were used for sword making not only in India, but in West and Central Asia as well. Now, the woods is an anglicized version of the Kannada word uku, Telugu huku and Malayalam urku, meaning steel. Now, Indian wood steel fascinated many European scientists as well. For example, Michael Faraday, the legendary scientist and discoverer of electricity and electromagnetism, spent 4 years studying the properties of Indian woods. However, the wood steel making process which was widely known in South India, was completely lost by the mid-19th century. Why? It was because the swords and armor making industry died with the conquest of India by the British, and the import of iron and steel from England replaced the iron and steel produced by the craftsmen of India. Now let's discuss about the abandoned furnaces in villages. Now, the production of wood steel required highly specialized technique of refining iron, but iron smelting in India was extremely common till 19th century. Particularly in Bihar and central India, every district had smelters, and they used the local deposits of ore to produce iron, which is widely used for making tools of their daily use as well. So this is an image of certain iron smelters of Palamau, which is in Bihar. Now, the furnaces that were used for making woods were most often built of clay and sun-dried bricks, and the smelting was done by men while the women worked with the bellows. This bellow is actually an equipment or a device that can pump air, and with the bellows the women pumped air that kept the charcoal burning. So even though iron smelting was common in India, by the late 19th century, the craft of iron smelting started declining. Why? Firstly, the colonial government, it prevented people from entering the reserved forest. We have already studied in chapter 4 how the forest laws were implemented by the East India Company. Hence, it was hard for the iron smelters to find wood for charcoal, nor could they get iron ore. Similarly, they often entered the forest secretly and collected woods. Many even gave up their craft and looked for other means of livelihood. In some areas, the government did grant access to the iron smelters, but they had to pay a very high tax to the forest department for every furnace they used. This reduced their income as well. Moreover, by that time, iron and steel was being imported from Britain. Most of the ironsmiths in India, they have started using imported iron to manufacture utensils and implement. This too lowered the demand for iron produced by the local smelters. And by the early 20th century, the artisans producing iron and steel faced a new competition. What was that competition? Let's see. The iron and steel factories came up in India. So now let's see how these factories came up in India. In 1904, an American geologist named Charles Weld, along with Turabji Tata, he was the eldest son of Jamshedji Tata, they were traveling in Chhattisgarh in search of iron ore deposits. And they found a group of men and women carrying basket loads of iron ore. These people were actually Agarias. When they asked where they found this iron ore, the Agarias pointed to a hill which was called as the Rajhral Hills, and it was one of the finest ores in the world. Actually, Jamshedji Tata, he wanted to build a big iron and steel factory in India. But there was a problem in setting up a plant. The water was not available. The region was very dry, and water necessary for running the factory was not found nearby. Hence, the Tatas continued their search for a more suitable place, and with the help of Agarias, a source of iron ore was discovered that later supplied the Bhilai steel plant. And after a few years, a large forest area was cleared on the bank of the river Subarnarekha, and a factory was set up with the industrial township known as Jamshedpur, and that factory was called as the Tata Iron and Steel Company, TISCO. And it started producing steel in 1912. We have explained more about this TISCO in Geography Chapter 5, Industries. If you have any doubt, please refer that video. So throughout the 19th century, India was importing steel that was imported in Britain. And Britishers also were unwilling to believe that the good quality steel could be produced in India. But by the time TISCO was set up, the situation was changing. Why? Because in 1914, the First World War broke out, and the steel produced in Britain now had to meet the demands of the war in Europe. As a result, the British steel imports that came to India started decreasing. And the Indian Railways also was expanding at that time. They also turned to TISCO for the supply of rails. and as a war dragged on for several years, Tisco had to produce shells and carriage wheels for the war. And over time, Tisco became the biggest steel industry within the British Empire. So just like the cotton textiles, iron and steel industry also expanded when the British imports that came to India declined. And this happened mainly during the First World War and after. And as the national movements developed and the industrial class became stronger, the demand for the government protection also became stronger. So that's all for this chapter. Tune in soon for the next session. Thank you so much. May God bless you all. Take care and bye-bye.